Good afternoon, Admiral Carter and Judge Wallach and our other distinguished guests today. My name is Colonel Art Athens, and I have the distinction and honor and privilege of serving as the director of the Naval Academy Stockdale Center for Ethical Leadership. And on behalf of the Stockdale Center, I'd like to welcome you to the Volgenau Honor, Courage, and Commitment Luncheon. We designed this particular event in a different way. One was to keep the audience small so that you would have a chance to interact with each other and potentially with the guest speaker either during or after lunch. And also to have different types of speakers. We've had journalists, we've had Medal of Honor recipients, and now we get to have one of the most famous coaches in the world of sports to be able to talk to us today. And the other part of this lunch is to enable different parts of the academy to see each other. Staff, faculty, coaches, midshipmen, some of you who don't get to have that interaction, to be able to do that at this luncheon. So we're trying to inspire and educate all that are here at the academy, and this is one of those opportunities to accomplish that mission. This lunchtime series is made possible through the generous gift of Dr. and Mrs. Ernst Volgenau. Dr. Volgenau is a 1955 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy and a former Air Force officer who helped develop space boosters, satellites, and computer systems, and taught in the field of astronautics. He is the founder and chairman of SRA International Incorporated, an information technology firm of about 6,000 people, which was listed on the New York Stock Exchange between 2002 and 2011, and is now privately held. SRA is headquartered in Fairfax, Virginia, and for 10 years in a row was on the Fortune magazine list of 100 best places to work in the United States. Sara Volgenau, his wife, is a 1957 graduate of Morehead State University and taught in the elementary school system for a number of years. Dr. and Mrs. Volgenau have 3 married daughters and 9 grandchildren. And we are very grateful for Dr. and Mrs. Volgenau's support for this program, even though they couldn't be with us today. We know this lunch is not possible without them. Coach Dan Gable, to me, is one of the most prolific athletes and coaches in modern sports history. So if you take a look at him as an athlete, as a high school wrestler, he compiled a record of 64 wins and no losses in high school competition. At Iowa State University, he was a 2-time NCAA champion, 3-time All-American, 3-time Big 8 champion, and won 117 matches with only one loss in a 4-year career. In the 1972 Olympics, he won the gold medal and did not surrender a single point to any of his opponents. Now, if you've ever wrestled, and you've wrestled in a tournament, to actually be able to go through any tournament without giving up any points is amazing. To do it in the Olympics is just incredible. Now he turns to coaching. So as a coach at the University of Iowa, his teams captured 15 NCAA team championships, with 9 of them in consecutive years. At that time, that equaled the longest streak of national titles won by any school in any sport. He won the Big Ten title for the 21 years he coached at the University of Iowa. He achieved a .932 winning percentage. He produced 152 All-Americans, 45 national champions, 106 Big Ten champions, and 10 Olympians. Coach Gable also coached a number of U.S. teams in international competition to include the Olympics and the World Championships. He's been selected for the USA Wrestling Hall of Fame and the Olympic Hall of Fame, and he's been named one of the 100 Golden Olympians, an honor bestowed to the top U.S. Olympians who have competed over the years for the United States. But I want to give you a personal note on one of the reasons I really wanted Dan Gable to be here. And that is, as I was in high school, as a 3-sport athlete, things were going great for me. And I had a tragedy in my life. My sister was killed in an automobile accident by a drunk driver, and it shook my world. And I really trailed off. I had just lost perspective. And I picked up an old Sports Illustrated magazine that had an article about Dan Gable, who lost a sister very tragically as well when he was young. And I read about how that sister became part of his inspiration to achieve and to do great things. And I kept looking at that article and I realized I want to be like Dan Gable. And I actually cut the picture out that was in Sports Illustrated of Dan Gable. I framed it, and I put it on my desk in my room, and I'd look at it every single day. And because of the inspiration of Dan Gable, I was able to complete my high school athletic career, be recruited here to play lacrosse at the Naval Academy, go on and be a volunteer high school and lacrosse coach for about 36 years. I have 10 children. All the boys in the family have all been wrestlers, and they all had to know about Dan Gable. And they had to know my story of why Dan Gable was such an important part of my life. But I look back and realize that truly was a turning point in my life, and it was because of this man and because of what he did with his life after a tragedy. And I'll always be grateful to Coach Dan Gable. Never knew that I'd have an opportunity to introduce him, but now I get to introduce him. But before he comes up, we're gonna watch a quick video about Coach Dan Gable.
Thank you. Thank you very much. 3-2-1-0 hour. That's my time to perform. I'm on stage here. That's the way I used to look at all my wrestling matches as an individual, as a competitor. The countdown to 0 hour. And then all the time in between till the next 3-2-1-0 was preparation time. Now, you might think a guy would be a fanatic with all the time in between with preparation time. But preparation time is more than just preparing exactly for that mat time or whatever episode that you're going to put yourself into a 0 hour, whatever that competition is. It's everything about your way of life. It's about coming home. It's about rehydrating. It's about nutrition. It's about studying academically. It's about liking to watch a television show. It's like calling your girlfriend. It's all a time in between that you need as a person to be able to get back into that 3-2-1-0 hour. And so it's my time to perform right here in front of you right now. It's countdown time. And a lot of that time in between is time that is spent very valuable, so the next time I get up to speak, I'm ready to go. So anyway, the Naval Academy. You know, I got to go back to the summer of 1971. That might have been the last time that I was here, and I couldn't find my way around, but the reason why is because when I was here, I was only inside a gymnasium as well for a month. And I didn't really look around, pretty much focused. And so I'm not even sure exactly where I was at, and I didn't see any place so far that really brought back the memories. I think there's another big armory somewhere that we used that's not right close to here. It might be a little ways, but we were in an armory. And for me, it was perfect because I've been to Russia 25 times, and I always say, well, what was it like in all these famous cities, old cities where you've been? I said, I was just inside a gymnasium. That's as far as I went. Now, if somebody went along, my wife, my kids, stuff like that, you know, they could tell you what else was going on. But from here at the Naval Academy in 1971, they actually brought bunk beds into the locker rooms inside the armory. And that's, we stayed right there. We lived right there. We slept right there. And I do remember going out of those, and we actually had a place to wrestle, but it was just mats down on the gym floor. It wasn't a wrestling room. There was a wrestling room, but we just put the mats down on the gym floor in the summer of 71. So I was here for over a month training for the Pan American Games. And then also the World Championships. Pan American Games were in Cali, Colombia, and the World Championships were in Bulgaria, Sofia, Bulgaria. But it was perfect for me. Might not have been so perfect for everybody, but for me, the coach was a guy named Blueball, Doug Blueball, and he was the kind of guy that, if you were the kind of guy like me, then he was a good athlete for him. It was either it was black and white, you know. So he worked us extraordinarily hard, and then he ran us extraordinarily hard. And right inside that armory was great running grounds, great wrestling grounds. We had our sleeping quarters, you know, that type of thing. We had a sauna right in the locker room. And so everything, we could just kind of stay right there. And by the way, at that particular time, I believe Coach Perry was the coach. And after that, a guy named Reg Wicks, who was a college teammate of mine at Iowa State, was the coach. We were both national champions together. We both actually won at, I believe it was at State College, Pennsylvania in 1968. And that I can remember training here, and I can remember actually leaving and then wanting to come back. That's how much this place meant to me. I didn't really remember the outside that much, except when we'd go for runs outside. I could kind of recall there was a lot of 7-Eleven stores. I don't know if they have them anymore around here. I know, but we'd stop there and kind of rehydrate. And we had one crazy guy on the team, and I never did it myself, but he would take these two pop bottles, open them up, and put both of them in his mouth and chug them all at one time. And I'm thinking, whoa, you know, this guy's little crazy. But I didn't pick up on that. I didn't pick up on that. But anyway, I think we had the longest wrestling tryout match in that old armory against. We didn't have a limitation of time in overtime, and it just went and went and went. I think the match lasted 40-some minutes at that time against a couple great wrestlers. It might have been Wayne Bachman. He might have been from the Air Force against a guy named Bill Shear. I'm not so sure exactly who it was. Now, don't hold this against me, but I had to wrestle actually on that floor to make the team, too. We had the tryouts here, and one of them was a Navy NCAA wrestling champion. And his name was, I think, Dan Muthler, I believe. That was the name. And he's probably still mad at me because I beat him up. I beat him up. Score was 25-0. So I still can't believe I didn't pin him, though. You know, that's just, how do you beat somebody up 25-0 without pinning them? And what's funny is the next match I had was, because there's only three of us that were trying out at that weight class. The next guy, who was not a Navy guy, but he was end up being a good wrestler internationally, I beat him 25-0 too. So to make the team, I in that old armory, I have some good memories of scoring 50 points to my opponent's zero. We went to Cali, Colombia, went to Bulgaria, and I was able to, because of the great training here, I was able to win gold medals for the United States of America. So I have fond memories, and I have my actually parents who are not alive today actually drove out here from Iowa and watched some of the workouts, and I can remember that as well. So anyway, a year and a half ago, I'm sleeping in bed. It's about 6 o'clock in the morning, and my wife had already been up, and she'd been on the computer. And she walked into, and she kind of whispered in my ear, and she said, "Dan, I saw some things on the computer that I don't know if it's true or not, but you might want to be concerned. The Olympics might drop the sport of wrestling." And I just said, "There's no way." And I rolled over, but no more than I rolled over, I jumped out of bed. And I just had to confirm or deny, which I figured it was a rumor, because there's a lot of rumors on the internet. And so I went to a credible page, and no, it was true. They had actually voted to kick wrestling out of the Olympic Games. And you know, that was about poor leadership. That's what it was about. The bottom line, it was about poor leadership. We had 24 people in international committee, on an international committee. And that international committee was located in Switzerland, led by three countries that really aren't big wrestling countries. The three main important people on that committee was from Switzerland, France, and Italy, which are not great wrestling countries. And how that happened in the first place is beyond me, that you would have your ranking officers from non-wrestling in your most highest prestigious committee for the sport in the world. And not only did you have 24 people, but you had these 23 of them were actually kind of helpless. It was more like a dictatorship, that really nobody could figure out how to want to do help this guy or even challenge him, because if you challenge this guy, you would find yourself somehow off the committee. The United States had one member, and I think they usually only have mostly one member per some per country. But it was so bad that that 23 people were doing nothing, and one person was doing it all, the head guy. And that's impossible to do something for 180 wrestling countries in the world. And actually, we found out the one person that was the leader was doing nothing. Had big 2 or 3 inch pages of a couple hundred pages to fill out, to turn in on a 4 or 8 year plan for the next Olympic Games. He would go to the back page and he would sign his name and turn it in unfilled out. And so you wonder why we were getting in trouble. You know, I knew it. You got to remember, when it's country against country, there's a lot of politics involved. And there's a lot of pride involved. And people do crazy things just to win athletic contests. Back in 1970, my first view of international wrestling, actually as an alternate, for some reason, they had these phones on these mat judges' table right by the mat. There was a referee and a mat chairman and a mat judge. Actually, it was on the mat chairman. And every once in a while, a phone would ring right during a wrestling match, and the referee would pick it up and answer it and put it back down and then go change the score. There was one guy back in 1970 that was actually up and above in a hidden box that was the head of the International Olympic Committee for wrestling that was deciding how he wanted the score changed back in those days, 1970. Well, they couldn't figure out how to get rid of him back then either. He was so corrupt. So they killed him, and they got rid of him. So they had a new one in 1971. Nobody ever knew who killed him, but you know he got shot, and you knew he was so bad that they couldn't find a way, so they killed him. So 1971 actually threw, for the next about 20 years, was a pretty decent guy, and wrestling was pretty solid, strong. And then all of a sudden, when this guy retired, he didn't get pushed out, he retired, a new guy came in, and that was the guy we had for about 10 years that was absolutely doing our sport an injustice. And we just really didn't know how to get rid of him, and nobody was wanting to kill him. And so, you know, it was one of these things that it was a force vote. And all of a sudden, wrestling decided that we no longer want to be just an individual person, that we will become a team. And we became a team in the world for a six-month period. We created this international committee called CPOW, the Committee for the Preservation of Olympic Wrestling. And some of the best minds in the sport, actually, and some of the richest people in the sport, actually, that helped out, gave us a chance to get back on track. Now, we've kind of let up in the last year since we've been in. And so I'm really, that's been my job to try to keep this going. And I'm not in the position, but they know how I feel, and I believe they're going to restart and continue to get that going. So we have something to look forward to instead of just going back. Because, you know, a culture isn't that easy to change, especially if you only change it for 6 months of a 50- or 100-year period. It's going to slide back into the similar type of culture. So we're working really hard on that leadership. And so we actually have a better chance to succeed now than we've ever had because of better leadership, and we have people in place right now. But again, they have to be reminded. They have to be reminded. And the actual head guy now is actually using his 24 people. And then he's also using the people beyond, which is very important. And so, speaking of leadership, I just want to read 4 or 5 things that I kind of wrote up here that I think is really important. It's about being the first one there. It's about being the last one to leave. It's about being the hardest worker, and over time, adding the smartest as well. First to arrive, last to leave, hardest and smartest worker. Now, as you get in your position for over a period of long time, you don't necessarily have to be the first to arrive. But you got to have somebody there that's in charge and somebody there that's really accountable that can keep you exactly up to date with everything. And that's what a good leader is about. A good leader figures a way to make accomplishments without going backwards. Sometimes in wrestling, we think we're tough because on the mat we can be pretty tough, but sometimes we're not so smart, and we have to be as smart. You know, sometimes they say it's so important to be just on time, which it is. But it's more important what you do with the next time limit that you're involved in that actual activity. So practice starts at 3:30 for wrestling. Yes, everybody's going to show up at 3:30 on time. But what really is important is that 3:30 to 5:30 time, what actually takes place during those 2 hours of practice. And that's more important than actually being on time, even though you need to do both. It's what you put into that time that's just unbelievably crucial. I remember one time I had an exception to this rule. And basically what it was I was the first one there, but I was the first one to leave. And that was when it came to knowing the rules for being an NCAA coach. And you could also bring in a thick manual of the NCAA to have an open book test. You could have open time, took as long as you want. You just have to pass this test. But I was the first to arrive, didn't carry a book in. First to leave, and never missed a question. The reason why is because there's people that look over you. And if they don't think that you know what you're doing, they're actually going to look over you too much. And so I want to keep those people off my back. So being the first one there, being the first one to leave, and never missing a question, and not even using the book, they left me alone. Because they knew that I knew what I was doing. That's really an important part. Perfect score every time. Perfect score. Never missed one. Now, after I set out one time, I came back as an assistant coach after 10 years. I had to take that book with me. I had to, because I missed 10 years. And to make sure that I would, in case I need to open the book. So anyway, leadership. It's knowing your subject. And it's knowing your subjects. And that's difficult. I mean, one person's in charge sometimes of a big group. And that's why you got to have assistance. And that's why you need help. But actually, for yourself to make the best decision, you're going to have to spend time not only being an unbelievable, have an unbelievable knowledge of the sport or whatever your area is, but whoever's involved in that. So if you have 40 wrestlers, or I guess the academy has 60 out, you have to know those subjects well, too, because you got to treat each one of them a little different than the next, even though they're a team, because each one of them actually contributes to that team in their own way. But you got to know that way. And for you as a person, that's an extremely hard, long process going back and forth. And usually until after you talk to somebody at least 30 to 40 minutes, you know when he's telling the truth and when he's not telling the truth. Because sometimes they just tell you what you want to hear. And you got to get beyond that. So it takes quite a bit of time. So knowing your subject and knowing your subjects, and it's staying current with both. Because right when you think you know this person, if you haven't seen it for 6 months, they could be changed. Or even with the subject or with the rules. Or with science. Science changes a lot, and you have to keep up with that. So it's like the way I trained my athletes at the beginning of my career in probably 1977. As the way I trained them in 1997, I was a lot smarter because things had changed. All of a sudden, you went from a discipline of no water to making sure they had all the water they wanted. And they got a lot more productivity out of them. But that's science. And you probably don't, some of you might not even know, understand that, what I'm talking about. Part of wrestling, part of sports was like, they didn't realize how much, how bad you needed liquids. Or just the fact of sending half my team running out on concrete while the other team was, because we have a small facility, wrestling, and not changing your shoes. So from you could get a lot of problems with infection, to just wearing down your knees with wrestling shoes who doesn't have any cushion running on concrete, to understanding all that stuff. And a good coach, a good leader, will stay current with science. Stay current with science. A good leader positively affects the masses, so they will do the same, and so on and so on. And that means in all walks of life, not just in your job, but also in your family. That's crucial. Affecting the masses. And just think about how lucky I was. My mom and dad sent me to wrestling camp when I was a kid. Depending on where you're born in the world, that kid could be sent to another camp, a different type of camp. He could be sent to a terrorist camp, for an example, as a kid. And that's the goal. The goal is to affect so many people positively over time with good people that no kid will ever be born ever in any corner of the world and have to be subject to that. That's a goal. That's a goal. And that means you have to do your part. Adversity is another part of leadership. I used to say you take it on or it takes you on. Then I said, no, there's no or in adversity. Adversity, you take it on. Easier said than done. Because it's not just about W's and L's. It's about life and death. That's adversity. But sooner or later, when you take it on, you can work it out. You can work it out. And then number five, which I was actually really good at this, it's called recovery. Recovery on a daily basis so you can wake up the next day ready to go. So for an example, when I was in my sport, I was always the last guy there in the room, always doing more extra, doing extra chins, rope climbing, throwing dummies, keeping people there and working. But then after I left there, when I went to the locker room, because you worked extremely hard, and I really wasn't probably as smart, but I was doing things that made me feel good. So everybody was gone. I'd go to the hot showers after 2 hours of wrestling training. I'd go to a cold plunge, cold showers. Once I got to college, they had a sauna there. They had a steam. They had actually massage people. I would take advantage and use all that stuff. And so for an hour straight after practice, I was the only one there. You know, after you started winning a lot of matches and other people started following you a little bit, and then we had more of a team doing things like that. But it's called a recovery. And so what I was really doing was I was getting ready to come back the next day ready to go, because I was doing things that were actually curing me from my 2 hours of hard training and getting me ready quicker than most other people. And this is what I did with my teams as well. But the real important part, there was all that time when you're actually sitting there relaxing, feeling good, your mind's thinking. Most people just leave automatically and hurry on to the next thing in their life. But I'm spending an hour of actually understanding what I did that day and what I want to do that night and what I'm going to do tomorrow. And so that's a lot of the mental part. So I'm thinking, I'm laying there and feeling good only because of the heat or the cold, whichever I needed. And all of a sudden, this guy had taken me down a couple times with the same move, and I'm analyzing this move in my mind, and so I'm actually training besides beyond the practice room. And by the time I'm done, I pretty much got it figured out what took place. So to me, that's real key. And I know sometimes the military life can be just regimented. Boom, 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 boom. You know, but there's got to still be some independent time in there where that person has the ability to develop his own mind as well. You have to remember that, because that is what top performance is all about. I know that you're a leader, and me as a leader, as a coach, I wanted every athlete to know what I knew. And the only difference between me and them was the respect that they had for me. They knew, and basically I had, instead of just 40 athletes, I had 40 coaches. And so when you go to class, and I don't know if you do this in Naval Academy, probably not, but when the instructor doesn't show up at 1 o'clock and it's 1:10, when I went to college at Iowa State, I just packed my books up and left because the instructor didn't show up. I don't know if you can still do that or not, and maybe you don't even do that here. Maybe they just all stay and open their books up and get all their stay for the whole hour and get all their work done. Well, in wrestling practice, when it's 3:30 and it's 3:31, if Coach Gable doesn't show up today, the wrestlers get up and go about their business in dutiful manner, and they stay this whole time, and they get just about as much out of it as if I wasn't there, as if I was there. The only difference is probably 2%, 3%, and 4%, because they're educated. They understand themselves. They understand the team concept. They understand the individual concept. They know what they to do, and it's not a day off. And that's, to me, real, real crucial in leadership. So leadership leads to performance. Good leadership leads to good performance. Bad leadership leads to bad performance and extermination, almost. But performance is about building to a certain level that you want to be. And then once you get built to that certain level, then you need to repeat it, repeat it, repeat it. So it's a repeat performance. When where a lot of people go wrong is if all of a sudden you have this team and some of them graduate and some of them retire and things like that. And you got some of them coming back, and you got brand new coming in, recruiting, or the ones that really haven't gotten to where they want to go. And so the coach says, okay, I have this four guys returning, or four team members returning and anything, and they're really good. They did really well last year, and I'm going to look at the rest of the guys that haven't done so well, new recruits. I'm going to spend all my time with the new recruits and all these guys, and I'm going to leave these studs alone. Because they're my leaders. Those guys aren't ready yet to be left alone. In fact, those are your guys that made you where you're at today. They need a lot. In fact, when they show that they can do it more than once, because if you look at the records at Iowa Wrestling, we've had one-time champions, two-time champions, three-time champions, four-time champions. Wow. Repeat performances. And all these other people are looking up to them. And if all of a sudden they don't come through, they don't see the same thing. It might not be as important to them. And so you need to continue to work with your leaders, even within the leader needs to continue to work within the leaders to make sure that they come through again, to make sure everybody, the effect that they can have, and these people looking up to them. And it's that important, that it's that important. But a lot of people just do the opposite. A lot of people just do the opposite. So repeat performance means the mainstay comes through again, and then plus one or two other ones. You're bringing them up. That's a repeat performance. Otherwise, you're going to fall back down to that building performance. And then all of a sudden, sometimes you could have what's called a record performance, and you don't really don't know what's going to happen. It just happens, a record performance. And usually it's a mental thing more than it is a physical thing. Learning from your past when to turn it on and not when to turn it and when to turn it off. I've learned the hard way. But the one thing, when you learn the hard way, you never repeat that mistake. You never repeat that mistake. So anyway, performance from good leadership, it's all about excellence. It's all about excellence. In Iowa, it's good to be known for something in Iowa. Otherwise, we wouldn't even know. Nobody would know where Iowa is. But everybody knows where Iowa is. If you're in wrestling and you're in Iran, or you're in Russia, or you're in Chechnya, or you're in Dagestan, they all know Iowa. You know why? Because Iowa's had 29 world and Olympic medalists. 29, that little state, 29. It's good to be known for something, and something that's good. In Iowa, it says here in Iowa we wrestle. You can see that. That's our state there. It says in Iowa we wrestle. But you know what? You know, besides actually those 29 world and Olympic medalists, 55 colleges have won national titles. 55! But Iowa, we also feed the world. We feed the world in farming. And nobody knows better than feeding the world than India or Pakistan, where this guy from Iowa, in Cresco, Iowa, a wrestling town, developed a process called greening process that took wheat, that broke it down and fed all these underprivileged countries, and they saved a billion lives. Norman Borlaug. They just put up a statue of him in Washington, D.C. because of him saving a billion lives with what he discovered. And you know what? He also was a wrestler. And he gives all the credit to wrestling because of the disciplines that he had to do to be able to stay up and study and work that extra hard. A great novelist, John Irving, 12 bestsellers, gives all the credit to wrestling. He says, I didn't develop the discipline needed to write in writer's workshop. I developed my skills there, but the discipline was from the sport of wrestling. And it doesn't have to be just wrestling. It's what it represents. So anyway, my mom, she had cancer about 5 times, because back in those days, my mom and dad, just like everybody else, drank and smoked, and you had no reason not to, because you didn't know that it was bad for you, up to a certain point in time. So finally, the hospital, they saw her, they closed the books on her, gave her a short period of time to live. This was in 1981. And so in 1981, the family grieved. And I just happened to live next door to a University of Iowa head of the Department of Otolaryngology. I couldn't even pronounce that word until my mom dealt with it. And he was the head of the department then. I was just telling him, like on a Friday night, about my mom at this one institution. And he said, well, why don't you bring her down? Let me look at her. I said, was that your area? He goes, yeah, it's my area. He says, well, I'll take a look at her. I said, well, you know, they closed the book. I don't know what you can do. He said, bring her down. So I talked her into it. She came down on a Sunday when nobody was there. He opened up the clinic. He had a big cowboy hat on, cowboy boots, big belt. He put this coal miner's light on his head. I didn't know what he was going to do. He walked in this room. 3 minutes later, he walks out. I go, do you need something, Doc? And he goes, no. I said, I found the source. I think I can take care of it. I think with some good surgery and good care, she'll be good. I go, wow. And she did. She lived another 17 years of pretty quality life. Because, you know, what's out there with that excellence, there's some really good doctors, and then there's some, you know, not so bad doctors. There's some really good wrestling coaches, and then there's so-so wrestling coaches. But as a matter of excellence. And so this doctor gave my mother, who had her only daughter raped and murdered right in her house, a chance to watch my 4 daughters grow up. I only had 2 at the time, but I had 2 more after that. And so she had several years with her grandkids just because of somebody of excellence, somebody that took the time to develop what's needed. So for me, it's like, yeah, I stopped in 1997. I was done walking in 97. But because of science, they used to call me the bionic man on the mat because I could just tear through everybody. Now they pretty much call me the bionic man, but because I got all these replacement parts. But it's, you know, I'm feeling pretty good. And I don't know if I can whip everybody in this room, but I could probably whip most of you. On the mat, anyway. Not gonna take you on underneath the water or anything, even though I swam a lot. So anyway, I'm just gonna leave you with this last part of excellence. And two other examples, actually. First, it was my leader. I was an assistant coach. The guy that hired me was the head coach for the first year ever. He was the first year ever for him to be a head coach at college. And after 1 month, he called me into his office and he said, Gable, I'm going to put you in charge of the wrestling room and all the training of all the athletes. And I go, wait a minute. I've only been a coach assistant for 1 month, and this is your first head coach job, and you're going to turn me over to that position. He goes, I can already tell you're better at it than me. And that's a sign of a good leader, because you're going to get more accomplished when you realize somebody can do something better than you, but yet you're even the higher rank, and you just find what you need to do. And he says, I love to recruit. I love to socialize. You know, I love to work in the office. You know, stuff like this. He says, but you're in the room. You're really good. That's what you're going to do. I thought that was an unbelievable move for a guy that had been waiting his whole life to take over and just give up the actual training of the athletes. And then the other one was the AD, who says, before we ever got started, when I got recruited at Iowa, he calls me and he says, Gable, you know, this wrestling's not quite like Iowa State, not like Oklahoma State, not like some other institutions. You bring the program up a little bit and you show promise here, and you come see me every time you show promise. I like that. It's not like I went in there and begged for all this money to get me to go to Iowa. And he called me in and he taught me a principle. But the principle really turned out well for me, because every year we did something great. And every year I was able to go back in his office, and every year I was able to say, you remember when you told me to come in when we do something well? And last year we needed new mats. This year we need a new locker room. And just, he came through every time too. But it's a good principle. Do something. Instead of complaining that you don't have it, do something. Show your worthiness. And then go in with some power, especially if you can get him to commit to, well, every year you do something pretty good. So to me, that's excellence. And here at the Naval Academy, when I read the newspapers in Iowa about, because that's who they'll publish, when a serviceman gets killed, I almost cringe every time, because I know when I start reading the obituary, it's going to be something about wrestling on there. And it's probably 50% of the time that the kid wrestled in high school, or he was, he played sports, or he did this and did that. But a lot of times in Iowa, you know, this kid that, you know, it just crushes me, you know. But I know for me it's like excellence for a Naval Academy or for any other division, whether it be the Marines. I'm not supposed to mention Army, I guess, but it's like you protect the United States of America. You protect the world. And sometimes with certain administrations, you may think that that's not really happening. But for me, with really great performances, we want to do that as an overall goal. But we want to do it with as little risk and with as little trauma as possible to families, to the people of the world. And to me, that's kind of like affecting the masses. But when you affect the masses, you don't have to do it at any cost. And the better you get, the more prepared you're going to be, the more excellent you are, the chances of that trauma will be less and still get great results. And I think that's what real leadership is all about. Real leadership finds a way to make it get accomplished instead of making it just go away to replace it with something else that is already possibly built and strong. And so that's where I'm at. And I just want to say I appreciate you giving me a chance to come back here. I haven't been back here since summer of 71. And I haven't really looked around much, I have to tell you. But I did see the wrestling room. That's pretty much all I want to see. And just as long as I know that's going strong and it's healthy, and actually you guys do it more than just your athletes. You do it to the whole 4,500 people, I think. So that's, to me, promotion. That's what I'm looking for. And I don't have to worry about you guys. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Coach Gable. We have something for you here from the Stockdale Center in the Naval Academy. It's a compass. We consider it the moral compass that you've obviously kept straight and true for all these years, and you can put it on your desk to remember us by. So thank you, sir, for spending time with us this afternoon.
Thank you.
So just so you know, there's a book that's on the table as you go out. The book is Season on the Mat, that chronicles Coach Gable's final season as Iowa's head coach. I know he'd be pleased to sign that book and chat with you. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time for questions, but if you have questions for Coach, he'll be up there for a while. If you're going to be late for your class, Admiral Carter, the superintendent's right here, so he can probably excuse you if you're a little behind. But we're glad that you joined us. I do want to thank Commander Jason Briannis, who's the center's deputy director, Marge Bem, the center's senior staff associate, Kathy Kindig from ITSD, and Ensign Ben Berkey, who were critical in making all this happen for us this afternoon. And I hope we can all go out with some of those thoughts that Coach Gable gave us about leadership, performance, and excellence, because we all need to remember that in whatever role we have here at the Academy, because it makes a difference for our nation. So thank you for being with us. God bless you. Have a good afternoon.